Hello, Yashni.
Good
Yashni,
evening,
can
sir.
you please? Yeah, please introduce yourself.
Sir, my name is Yashni.
Yeah.
I'm basically from Tamil Nadu, but I am born and brought up in Arunachal Pradesh. I did my engineering, electrical engineering, and since 2016, I have been working in RBI as a manager in Reserve Bank of India, Trivandrum office.
All right. How do you find your job?
It is satisfying job, sir. It is a good job.
Very satisfying. Then why do you want to leave it?
Sir, in RBI also we are, whatever we do, we have a sense of satisfaction that we are serving the people. But our reach is limited, sir. We only look after the economic areas, the credit mainly. However, civil service gives me a broader horizon. Economic, social, cultural, everything.
Okay, you are already employed, but then a lot of other unemployed engineers. Why engineers are applying for the civil services these days? Vast majority of the applicants are engineers. Why? What's the reason?
Sir, the reason actually, in my opinion, sir, the reason goes back to they're opting for engineering itself. These days, a large number of students are opting for engineering. Other profession is not given much thought. So only after engineering, other professions are given a thought. So as the number of graduate itself was more are engineers, so naturally they are coming more to civil service also, in my opinion.
Okay. Okay, good, good, interesting. So this pandemic, this corona pandemic has exposed some of the chinks in our armor. Millions of people were trying to go back to their homes by road, bicycles, trucks. So in 70 years of India's independence, this is the situation. And what is the reason for this massive poverty and unemployment in this country?
So reason for poverty and unemployment, sir, and the migration that followed post the lockdown. So in my opinion, it is more of a disbalanced regional development. Some areas of India, like more mainly the urban cities and the western and southern states, they have prospered compared to the heartland states, the states dependent mainly on agriculture. There has been stagnancy in agriculture also, and since over 50% of population are employed in agriculture, so they have not been able to enjoy the fruits of development as we see in the rest of the country. Sir,
what are the regions which are well developed and what are the regions which are ill developed?
Yes, sir. So the most important reason behind that is, in my opinion, stagnancy of agriculture, sir. There are small agriculture holdings are small, not much technological improvement has happened, and aggravated by natural incidents like floods and droughts, and bottlenecks are infrastructure bottlenecks. 30% of fruits and vegetables are getting wasted. There are middlemen involved. Licensing norms are there, so that benefits of, even if price increases, benefits are not going to the farmers. So that has led to poverty.
In terms of per capita income, can you list out the first five states with highest per capita income in India?
Sir, I'm not very sure, but of the order, but top five states should be Goa, Chandigarh, Delhi, and sir,
what about Kerala?
So Kerala is somewhere in 7th or 8th. Tamil Nadu is above it. Tamil Nadu and Maharashtra are above it.
Not sure.
Yes, sir. Kerala, Tamil Nadu and Maharashtra are above it.
Okay, you are a student of international relations.
Yes, sir.
What went wrong in the international relations between India and China that the Chinese army has to come and occupy some of the places, some of the disputed areas, or at least in the LOC, LAC, line of actual control?
Yes. Sir, more than our foreign policy gone wrong, I think it is a case of superpower going wrong. They have increasingly turned aggressive and assertive, not just with India, but across all the neighbors and other countries. So sir,
that is the reason.
Yes, sir. Here, and coupled with the fact that we are developing our infrastructure capabilities, which could change the status quo. There, the Chinese are better positioned than us in water areas. They have better infrastructure. Now that we are also catching up on that, so that made them act fast, like against us, in my opinion.
So this is 2020. Do you know the GDP difference between these two countries, or at least per capita income of between these two countries?
Per capita income of China is roughly around 4 times more than us. Ours is around $1,600, and theirs is around $7,000, I think. Even in terms of GDP, we are $3 trillion, and they are around $12-13 trillion.
Okay. What is the situation in 1962 when we had a war with them? We had the same problem in the same place almost, 1962. And again in 65. At that point in time, 1962, do you know the per capita of India and China? How many times China was more at the time?
Sir, I think in 1962, we were almost the same, or India was slightly ahead, I think.
Yes.
I'm not very sure. But
almost same. We are almost same as them. So what happened between 1962 and 2020? What has really happened? Why we have lagged behind, or why they raced ahead of us in national wealth and per capita?
Sir, they surged ahead of us only from the late 1970s, sir, because of their liberalization program, their subsequent emergence as a global manufacturing hub. It is now an economic powerhouse, which is also defining its military strength and reach worldwide. So now that it feels that it is a global superpower, so it can flex its muscles and all the border tensions.
Trade surplus or deficit between India and China?
The trade surplus, sir?
Yes.
Around $60 billion was there in 2018, which had dipped slightly this year. I think $50 billion this year, sir. Deficit.
All right. So, Professor James Kurian.
Good afternoon, Rashmi.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. Yeah. Rashmi, have you heard about Medha Patkar?
Medha Patkar, sir.
Yeah. What context, sir? She is.
Yes, sir. Narmada Bachao Andolan, sir. She is leading.
What was the problem there? What was the issue over there?
Sir, vast tracts of land were submerged after the Narmada Dam, and she is leading the fight of the localites, the tribals, who have been displaced and not adequately resettled, rehabilitated.
Every developmental activity will lead to some sort of difficulties for a small number of people. A few people may get displaced. If it is benefiting irrigation in a large part of the country, then displacement is natural for some people. No? Some villages may get submerged. But if you are an administrator, how will you look at this kind of a situation where benefits are more, disadvantages for less? And there are people who speak for that disadvantage to small sections in the society, like Medha Patkar. What is the argument they are putting forward to? What is the argument which Medha Patkar is putting forward? Because it is a developmental activity. It is benefiting a large number of people. But why she came forward with Narmada Bachao Andolan?
Sir, their argument is that the displaced people were not adequately resettled. If they are adequately resettled, and in the planning stage itself of any project, we involve the local community and discuss with them, and proper environmental impact assessment is carried out. So such instances of protest afterwards can be minimized, sir. But every developmental activity will have consequences. But we need to build a consensus so that the impact of protests are minimized.
Yashdi, you were in Arunachal Pradesh in your student days.
Yes.
Something similar is happening in Dibang Valley.
Yes, sir.
What is the status of that? What is the issue over there?
Yes, sir. Sir, Dibang Valley is a biodiversity hotspot. It is under the Bhim Dibang Biosphere Reserve. There, one hydropower project has been proposed, Italian hydropower project, 2 gigawatt. So that one, sir, local people and environmentalists, they are like protesting against it. Yes, so there are allegations that environmental impact assessment also was not comprehensive. Some intellectuals have come out against that report also.
Yeah. Post-independence period, immediately after independence, we were saying our dams, especially Fakra and Angal, and our dams are the temples of the modern India. How do you look at a dam as a source of energy and as a model for development? Big dams. Is it a good model for development? How do you look at dams?
Yes, sir. So dams do have their benefits, sir. Dams are for flood control also, irrigation benefits also. For example, Damodar River, Damodar Dam, it tamed the Damodar River, which was called the Sorrow of Bengal. So dams have benefits. However, sir, we need to look at the cost as well. For example, Italian hydropower project, it is in a biodiverse area. It's in a level 5 seismic zone. So there, sir, dams, we can go for other alternatives also. So we can explore other alternatives before dams should be, in my opinion. Now growing consensus is there, sir, in international bodies also, that dams should be the last option. Other projects could be envisioned, like run-of-the-river projects or small hydel projects or other renewable agency, energy, then dam could be even dams is a model of development, sir. If we see in Chotanagpur Plateau also, it has led to localized area of development. The entire area has not developed, but islands of development is there.
Why displacement? You know, when there is a major project anywhere, major project is taking place, there's a displacement. Now, is a displacement only an issue of compensation, or is there anything more than that? Like, you know, 1 acre land is taken and you give 5 times more than that. Now you are compensating it. Is compensation enough to solve the problem of displacement?
Compensation is not entirely enough, sir. Certain areas, they have most of the development projects, sir, they will be in and around forest areas for mining or for dam projects. So that is inhabited by indigenous people. And those areas might be the only home they have. And like the case of Niyamgiri Hills, those places might have a religious or cultural significance.
Exactly.
So all that is threatened when we shift the people from their place.
Yes,
however, to minimize the grievance, a compensation should be a well thought of compensation, and it should include more than the land value, and should include all these considerations.
Excellent. Thank you so much. My questions are over, sir.
Okay. Now, the member Boko Saravanan, IRS, please.
Good evening, Ashley.
Good evening.
And okay. When I utter the word Northeast, what comes to your mind?
Sir, my home, sir.
Other than that, you can say 3 to 4 sentences.
Okay. Sir, Northeast is a very beautiful place, sir. The first idea comes to my mind is rivers and mountains and greenery and the tribal people, sir. And as the tagline of tourism goes, paradise unexplored. It is very less explored, sir. It has beauty, immense beauty.
Okay, great. And geopolitical commentators call this Northeast a troubled periphery. Why so?
Sorry, sir?
Geopolitical commentators in India, yes, and outside India call Northeast as troubled periphery.
Troubled periphery.
Why? What is the reason why it is called as troubled periphery?
So it could be due to the presence of many insurgent groups. There are Bodo insurgent groups, Alpha is there in Assam, in Northeast, Arunachal and Nagaland, there is NSCN. In Tripura, there was Tiger Liberation Force. It's a whole lot of... can I have one moment, sir? Can I have one moment, sir?
Yeah,
one
moment. Yeah, please, please. Yeah.
I'm sorry, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. So, because of presence of many insurgent groups, I think that is why it might be called troubled periphery. It shares.
And also to do with our neighbors who are there, like China and whatnot.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay, yes. Forget about that. And recently, the Indian government had abrogated Article 370. And I am not going to ask about Article 370. It had sent jitters across Northeast people. What is their apprehension about abrogation of 370? Abrogation of 370.
Sir,
why they were
worried? Yes, sir. So Article 370 had given special status to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Not alike, in a similar manner, not similar also, but little bit on the same lines, many other states also had been given special provisions under Article 371. So mostly states of Northeast like Sikkim, Arunachal Pradesh, Nagaland. So these special provisions enabled them to protect their culture, have some autonomy in their administration and even in their socio-economic matters, socio-cultural matters. So there was apprehension that as 370 was revoked, it could have in future there also independence could be revoked. But in my opinion, sir, those doubts or those apprehensions were cleared by the Home Minister when he said that 371 will not be touched. And moreover, 370 was in the Constitution itself. It was written that it is a temporary provision. But however, it has not been mentioned like that for other states in 371.
I have another question for you. This is to add to this 371 only. What is the difference between NRC and PRC?
NRC is National Registry.
Yes, NRC and PRC.
NRC is a register of citizens. PRC is also a register of citizens only, permanent residents. No, permanent residence. So PRC is a residence certificate. However, NRC is a register of citizenship. NRC is applicable only in the state of Assam as of now. PRC is for residents.
Okay. Why there were protests in Arunachal Pradesh with respect of PRC? There were recently protests in Arunachal Pradesh against PRC. What was the issue? Can you elucidate?
Yes, sir. Sir, in Arunachal Pradesh, there is a system of inner line permit system. And also, non-Arunachalis, they are, even to enter Arunachal Pradesh, they need a pass and they cannot buy property there. Land and property they cannot buy. So, now recently, protests erupted because government had decided that some communities which had been living there for a while, they would be extended these PRC facilities, residency certificates. So, for that, protests had erupted, sir. In the communities, actually, sir, what the contention of the people is, some of these communities, like some Gorkha communities or some tribal communities of Assam, which have settled in that area, so they have a larger number in Assam or neighboring states. So if these people are given PRC, their numbers would increase and indigenous people will be affected. So indigenous population there is only around 7 or 8 lakhs. Total population is around 12-13 lakh.
So, okay, my last question for you. What is your idea of India?
Idea of India is...
What is your idea of India?
My idea of India is a great nation, a historic nation with diverse population, an aspiring superpower, aspiring global power, an economic powerhouse.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Yeah. Yashini, what's the exact reason why you want to go back to Arunachal Pradesh? That is your first choice, it seems. You want to go back there.
Yes, sir. Sir,
but you appear to be from Tamil Nadu state.
Yes, sir.
Born and brought up in Arunachal Pradesh. You want to settle down and you want a Arunachal Pradesh cadre. What is the reason?
Sir, as a sir, Arunachal Pradesh is not one of the very well developed states of India. There is a lot of potential to work there. And as a tribal state, which has given me so much, sir, it has enabled me to sit here in front of you all. So I want to go back and serve the state, sir. In front of my eyes, I have seen many problems.
Okay, fine. You are a district magistrate of a particular district in Arunachal Pradesh. What are the plans? What are the plans that you have for the women of them at the district?
For the women of the district, sir.
Yes.
So for the women of the district, first thing would be, sir,
if you want to empower the women, anyway, Arunachal Pradesh women are generally better empowered than the rest of the country. Okay, still, what best you can do to empower them?
Sir, women of Arunachal Pradesh, they are empowered, sir. But in terms of literacy, it is the women literacy in Arunachal is the third lowest in India. So women literacy is there only around 57 or 58%.
They are more independent than the women of Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, right?
Yes, sir. They are more independent,
more free,
more liberated. Yes, sir. And such social practices like dowry or infanticide is not there.
Yeah.
Sir, what I can do is for women, one thing would be, sir, to focus on women education. Many schools, they do not have toilets, or women or children, kids are generally sent for foraging of woods and other stuff. So that one focus would be on women education. Second thing would be on livelihood, sir. Now women generally do all the sustenance livelihood. They walk for miles for woods, and agriculture also, shifting agriculture is there. Second thing would be for livelihood. Yes, and third thing would be for healthcare, sir. So large parts of the state, even access to ambulance is not available. Mortality rates are high. So in my opinion, sir, if infrastructure is given a push, infrastructure and livelihood, if it is given a push, all other problems you can address, sir.
Okay.
I would like to
socially. Yeah. Socially and keeping Northeast in mind, what is your take on decriminalization of adultery by the Supreme Court of India? Supreme Court has decriminalized adultery. So today in India, adultery is not a crime. What is your take on that? Do you support this or do you think it's not a good idea?
Yes, sir. I support the decriminalization of adultery, sir. So if at all, it should be a civil offense, sir. If it leads to suicide or abetment of suicide, then it can be investigated from that angle. However, adultery by itself, it should be a civil offense, sir. Not okay. A criminal.
Do you know on what ground this criminal section is repealed?
Yes, sir. Sir, the adultery law was also very vaguely termed, sir. Only if a wife did not have recourse to it, sir. I think only if he has relations with a married woman, then he could be tried. It was more like woman as a
man.
Can
be prosecuted if the lady's husband gives a complaint. That
yes,
goes to show that lady is a private property of a man.
Yes, sir.
It's on that ground only this was repeated.
Yes.
Okay, Ashni, your interview is over. So I'll give a briefing about your performance. You are a very, very charming, very serious, positive girl. I think you should be able to score a very, very high marks. You are not wearing your specs, but in your DAF, you are wearing your specs.
Yes.
I don't know. You're in the UPSC hall, I don't know.
Yeah, I have it.
Earlier we had a candidate, he had a wig which was freshly put up. Okay, now we can make out it's you. So otherwise absolutely your performance is very, very good. You should be able to score a high mark. You're already a great B officer at the Reserve Bank of India, so it shouldn't be a problem at all for you. It should be a side, but you should not make any serious mistake like arguing with them, or you're not done it, and you are not also said something which is not correct. So you are much, very much in control. I'm very sure you should be able to score a good mark. Yeah, all the best to you and Professor James.
Yashni, you have done very well. You are very confident. You are doing very well, and you have a special sort of the way you are exposed at a very young age. You are exposed to have an idea of Tamil Nadu, Kerala, and Arunachal Pradesh. The southern part and the northern part of India, we have a familiarity. And Arunachal, people will be a little interested to know your views on Arunachal. There are issues pertaining to Arunachal, China's claim and all kinds of. So, you don't belong to the tribal community, but then you have an idea of Arunachal. And your idea of Arunachal will be, people will be curious to know about it. How familiar you are with Arunachal, being away from South India, to a different land, what you have observed, what you have seen, what are the good lessons you learned there, what are the drawbacks you have found. So it's a special combination. Your exposure at a very young age to these three states or these three or two distant places can invite some questions. So, otherwise, you have done very well, Yashni. You are a very strong candidate. You are a very good candidate. I wish you all the best.
Thank you, sir.
Is your mother from Northeast or both of them from Tamil Nadu, Trichy?
Yes, sir. My mother is Nepali from Assam.
Okay. That's an attachment to Northeast.
Yes, sir. So, both of them came.
Your father retired.
Sir? Yes, sir. Sir, both were serving in Arunachal Pradesh. My father is engineer. My mother was in High Court.
Okay.
Both have now retired.
Yeah. So, who goes around and
IRS? Okay. Yes. Yashni, you really did well. And your answers came from the heart. It is not that you are faking your answers. You really gave answers from the heartfelt answers were there. And you were empathetic and you are sometimes you are a bit hesitant, but you are honest. So your answers are fine. Only one suggestion which I have for you is that have some eye contact when you are not comfortable with the answering also. Sometimes when you are not comfortable with the answer, you are not very sure. You go down, your face goes down, and have the eye contact with the interviewer. Otherwise, you are fine and your interview will be a joyous experience because I can see you are stressed with your work. Don't worry, your interview will go fine because it's a personality test. It is nothing like where your information and whatever you memorize will be tested. Your personality is very amazing and you would carry that. So don't worry about your workload and just enjoy the interview, but have an eye contact. When you even don't know the answer, your personality would ensure you would sail through. So please have the eye contact. Otherwise, you are doing fine. You would get very great marks. All the very best for getting Arunachal Pradesh, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure.